It's only after really reflecting on this podcast that I've realized how much of an impact Latin American parkour has had on my life. Whether it's the Yalabacas and their Chilean roots, the urban runners from Mexico, in particular Dea Sanchez, or quietly, in some small pocket of my soul, Pedro Thomas from Brazil, whose videos are in that very, very small minority of actually portraying what parkour feels like, how it can be pursued as a physical practice, but also expressed as an artistic and perhaps spiritual journey. Jorge sentou praça na cavalaria. Eu estou feliz porque eu também sou da sua companhia. The music you're hearing in the background is one of Pedro's videos called Inquebrável, which means unbreakable. And it really is such a simple video. It just shows Pedro doing some precision jumps. But it's very clear that these really are precision jumps. The razor-sharp intention that he has with his movement is mirrored very nicely in the execution of his landings. And I remember watching this as an 18-year-old and finding it very peaceful and impactful. I get it that a lot of people nowadays don't really want to go into the woo-woo mystique of parkour, but I still think it has its place, and parkour is something to be experienced, enjoyed, and that is going to have an effect on your psyche and your emotions. So it's people like Pedro that really helped me realize that I wasn't alone in feeling a sense of wonder in what we're doing. Now, for today's episode, I'm really thrilled to have another Brazilian, my first Latin American, Raíssa from Curitiba. I reached out to her after seeing one of her tutorials, and this was all in Portuguese, but was good enough that I understood what was going on. I then explored her Instagram, and it turns out she is very active on there, whether it's her online coaching, tutorials, topics and discussions surrounding parkour, and her training, of course, as well. We get into a bunch of these things. We explore the concept of tactful coaching, and also hear about the strong women scene in Brazil, who have been holding annual jams for 12 years now. So, wherever in the world you're listening from, make yourself comfortable and heed the words of a relentlessly passionate and inspiring lady. This is episode 44 of Parkour Coach Companion with Raíssa. Aproveitar. I'm hoping that's right. Wow, you're on the other side of the world. That's so cool.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, the power of... Tell me.
How did you get to my account? Like, how to get to my Insta and saw my post, my posts and everything?
Yeah, good question, actually. I don't know. I follow lots of people. And yeah, I think maybe I saw one of your reels. I think I saw maybe one of your reels and I was like, oh, it's like a coaching thing and you're doing like a tutorial. Yeah, it was. Yeah, because I commented saying that even though it was in
Portuguese,
I could still like understand. So yeah, good coaching.
Thank you. That's nice.
Yeah, and then I kind of like spent all of yesterday just going through Google Translate, like all of your captions. Uh-huh. So yeah, it was fun.
A lot of things in Portuguese makes a lot of more sense than when you translate it, you get lost so many, you know, inside jokes and stuff
of course. of course. Yeah.
How long do you have been coaching?
I think it's going to be the other way around. You're going to be doing the podcast with me. Yeah, I've been coaching since about 2012, so about 10 years.
10 years now.
Yeah. So when I was at university, there's like a few guys that I taught like for free, like on campus, and it was like an unofficial club.
Yes.
And then I found like a youth center and started teaching children in a different city. And then, yeah, lots of things have happened. And now I'm teaching like 5 or 6 days a week. So, yeah, a lot.
A lot. Yeah. That's nice.
Yeah. Thank you. Hey, you can analyze my Portuguese. I have some phrases here that I got ready. So do you say tudo bem?
Tudo bem?
Tudo bem.
Isso.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Isso, it's, yes, that is, I don't know, isso. Right, isso.
And then like, olá, bom dia, boa tarde, boa noite.
Yes. It's good. It's good.
But I haven't been to a Portuguese speaking country before.
Yeah, I think it's only no, that's more countries. I would say it's only Portugal and Brazil, but there's some countries in Africa also speaks Portuguese. But here in South America, it's just Brazil. I don't know why. So there's two guys from Argentina here in Brazil. They are here in Curitiba and we are training and they speak Spanish. And I feel kind of ashamed of myself as being Latina, I don't know, South American, and I don't speak Spanish. I speak better English than Spanish.
Oh, really?
Yes. But we can understand the Spanish because it's a similar language.
Similar.
Like, yes. But it's kind of, I feel shame for myself. Like, come on, we surrounded by these countries that speak Spanish and it's very common in Brazilian people, we don't speak Spanish. We tend to learn, I don't know, other languages than Spanish in schools and everything. It's more a cultural thing, you see, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we learn German and French, but no Spanish or Portuguese or, you know, Afrikaans or or Cantonese or some of my family is from Hong Kong.
Oh, right.
So like my grandfather's side, he was from Hong Kong. But I don't
so
know.
So you speak Mandarin?
No. Maybe one day. We'll see. It'd be nice. I want to learn French as well because parkour is French and I feel like, well, it came from France and I feel like that would be a nice homage to the French founders to actually be able to speak the language and yeah, so we'll see. Have you been to France? Have you been to Europe?
No, never. I never made a trip outside of Brazil.
Really?
I'm only travel in Brazil.
Yeah.
Only.
Okay.
I went to Paraguay once and Argentina once, but it was just a one day thing. So yeah. I don't even consider it.
Yeah. How are the, you've done some other podcasts before, right?
Yes, in Brazil. Yeah. With some friends of mine of here.
And how were they? How were they, those experiences?
It was cool. I started to coaching like in 2010.
Mm-hmm.
I was like 6 months of training and they invited me to, to do a workshop with some guys who are already training and et cetera. So, I was not very confident at the moment, but yes, like 12 years from now, I'm already better at this point. So in 2019, I became, I don't know how the word is in English, but I started to do the to make planned the straight training for Camila. I don't know if you know Camila.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a big thing in Brazil. Like, it was not a common parkour athlete or a tracer parkourist. I don't know. have a coach, like a strength training, and me and Camila, we decided to give it a try and learn with each other, like with my experience in college and, you know, in physical education and etc. And we decided to explore more these things, and people get very curious about it. So I was invited to do some lives and podcasts and other things that parkour people here in Brazil was creating, like content creator. Mm-hmm. And we talk about it, something like that. But at the moment, when I started to do these interviews, I was not fully conscious, I don't know, of what I'm doing. Like, I'm just exploring and knowing and the practice, because there's a difference in if you read a book and if you have to put in on practice, right? So it was a challenge for me, and explain why it was a challenge, it was really harsh, but I think I opened a lot of possibilities to other parkour coaches in Brazil to see that it's possible. Like, parkour people here in Brazil, I don't know if I think it's kind of world scene. They have a pretty closed mindset for some things, like that sometimes can be can help. I don't know how to say. I don't even know how to say in Portuguese, because some people get offended by it. Mm-hmm. So imagine in English. But they think some kind of things we can add to parkour, and possibly hurt parkour values in some way.
Okay.
So there's this resistance to you have a coach now, you don't train real parkour. Mm. Oh, you only train parkour gyms, you don't train outside. And some things, I don't know, I know where it came. I know the origin of it, and I somehow understand and agree at some point, but I think the resistance more goes, you know,
yeah.
It's difficult. It's really challenging. So when I started, I was attacked a lot by some people here, because I, you know, as a woman and et cetera. But anyways, and I continue, and Camila continued too, and she's getting, you know, now she's living in Lisbon, and she, right at the moment, she's recovering herself of a injury, but I think she's doing great. Like, I'm happy to do what I did and at the time, and you know, I think it opened some possibilities to other parkour coaches here and some other places to get into it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think it's always exciting to me when I know that there's a really talented athlete that's very well known, like Camila, and then I hear about who's behind the scenes, you know, who helped mentor them, who helped coach them. And in your, you know, in your case, you were the one that helped her. So I love that, because it's kind of like the seeing the lineage of parkour athletes, I think, is fascinating to me. Seeing who comes from where, who helped them, who gave them the spark in their mind that they they wanted to pursue parkour, or who helped them get over some fear, or who helped them with a challenging period in their life. Or and that's why I find coaching so powerful, is because we have the potential to uphold this position for someone else.
Yes.
So you must be very proud of Camila.
Yes, I saw her grow up in some way. She is from a city nearby Curitiba, where I live. So we met each other at some jams and training and stuff like that. And she came to live in Curitiba, which is a bigger city than her hometown. Mm-hmm. So, and when she came, lived here, she was only, I think, 16 at the time. Mm-hmm. And she came by herself and moving and living alone. I don't know. She's very brave. I say this to her very often. Yesterday, we were just talking and we were remembering some things that she passed at that time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we were talking before, and I was saying that I found you on Instagram via a kind of reel that you made, a tutorial. And I noticed that you make quite a lot of different content on Instagram and YouTube. And I know that you do online coaching as well. And that's really interesting to me. And I read, well, I've used Google Translate to read a lot of your captions. And it seems that you, similar to my last guest, Renee, you have like a playfulness to you, but also you take coaching very seriously. And I noticed that you use a phrase, awareness, consistency, and patience, as a kind of mantra. Catchphrase.
Catchphrase, yes.
Yeah. So I guess my question is really like, what motivates you to take, or maybe what did motivate you to take coaching more seriously and project yourself as a professional with strong ideas like awareness, consistency, and patience? And
let me see. I like to be very playful in Instagram. I think I don't have I don't cringe doing things people normally cringe. So and I am exploring all the tools, the social media. I don't know. I like to explore things. So I think humor, it's a thing that I don't know, people pay more attention than if I just talking serious, it's boring. Because I don't know, I don't think people like, I'm going to open Instagram right now and I'm going to study something. I don't know. I think people don't tend to be that way. I think I have 10 minutes of free time. I'm going to open Insta and check what, scrolling and et cetera. So, I like to do this kind of mix of information and humor. I think it works well. So I was coaching, in 2010 I started coaching, but it was like some little workshops, and here in Brazil we call oficina, but I think workshops it can be translated as well. So I like 1 hour class for beginners and universities and schools and stuff like that, but it was not regular classes. And 2012, I started to do regular classes, like for adults and children, and it was really cool and I learned a lot because I was like a freshman in college. So I didn't know anything what I was doing, but I learned a lot. And in 2013, I was I decided to be more productive in academic issues, like start to do research, like, and I stopped to do regular coach and came back to workshops and stuff like that. And in 2017, I came back to do regular classes as parkour coach in a parkour gym here in Curitiba. And I worked there for until 2020, like. And when I left this job, I decided to, do things by myself. And it was a long journey, like, of self-knowledge. And I went to, I don't know, I think I never get to know me better than at this time when I left this job. And for me to stand by myself and say, no, I'm a parkour coach and I'm gonna do classes for me and for my students and make my own group, it was challenging, and I like a lot what I do right now. So I think 2020 was the time when I really dive into this coaching thing, like, more seriously. Because when I was a parkour coach in a parkour gym, it was like, I don't know, I was really comfortable in some ways. I didn't have to expose myself in some way. So when I became a solo, I don't know if I am an entrepreneur. I don't know if that's right. But I'm considering myself like I work for myself. So when I decide that, I have to do this decision to be more open to other things and explore more and be more exposed also. So, and I try to link things that I'm learning, I'm studying, and into parkour coaching. And then I decided to share my parkour journey, not as only as a coach, but as a parkour parkourist, parkour practitioner, or whatever, and free runner. I don't know if I can call myself a free runner. So and then I was thinking about my parkour journey, and I was like, yeah, but I have to be aware of what I'm doing, aware of what I'm feeling when I'm training. So I think awareness, it's the first step for anything. And then when you know what you're doing right, or what you're doing wrong, and what you need to improve, and what you need to do to improve, you have to be consistent. Like, you have to be consistent with the plan of what you're doing, and you have to be patient. Because I think when I started to do Insta content, a lot of people came ask me some questions that the only answer is you have to be patient. Like, I'm starting parkour like for 2 months now, and I don't know how to Kong. Okay, then you have to be patient. So, you know, you're aware of what you're doing, you're aware of what you're not doing and stuff like that. But it's kind of, when I look to my own parkour training and journey, I was like, oh, okay, I think awareness and consciência, consistência, paciência. In Portuguese, it's like, it rhymes, right? So, consciência, consistência, paciência. Então, it's a catchphrase.
Yeah, nice, very good. Well, you know, you're set for life now. You have your own catchphrase, so.
Yes.
lovely. No, I like that. I like that phrase. I think it's it rings true. I think that patience, especially, is something that it's hard to teach, but so valuable when it's absorbed.
Yes.
When people realize that this thing takes time, takes effort, it takes a lot of trial and error, you know, it takes a lot of falling and sometimes hurting yourself and getting yourself back up again and trying again and getting stronger. And yeah, so on that note, actually, another thing you mentioned is about creativity, the link between creativity and making mistakes. And you wrote something along the lines of, if you risk making mistakes, then you plant the seeds of creativity. So what I want to kind of investigate with you is your coaching environment and how you help your students feel comfortable to, first of all, put effort into the class and succeed and have fun, but also to make mistakes and not to feel too demoralized. So do you have like any methods, or what goes through your mind when you try and make a class more comfortable for people to fail and to not always succeed first time?
Before parkour, I came from dancing. I danced like ballet, jazz, stuff nice. Like that. And it was when I was training and practicing, I forgot the word, but it was a ambient place. I don't know. Mm-hmm. It was really harmful, like hostile, and sometimes
yeah.
with mistakes. Yep. You can't do mistakes. You have to. And this seek of perfection, like you have to be perfect, and the posture, and all those things. It came as like I felt like I'm closed in a box, right? So when I met parkour, I feel a lot of free of those things, like and mentally. It was not movement, still movement, but mentally I felt more free, like, besides that, but parkour doesn't, no, it's not every time or everywhere I feel this. Sometimes with some people, some groups, I think people are already with this judgment and perfectionism. Like I can't say like it's everywhere, it's everything. No, I think for good people it's a lot of different sometimes. But and I saw that it can be different, like my relationship with movement. So I think my coaching experience came by a lot of things that I passed by, that I experienced myself as a practitioner of movement, like not only in parkour but in dancing. I used to run, I trained in CrossFit once, so it varies. So I tend to search for my experience as a practitioner to do the coaching, like with the mentality as well. So I don't have a method, but I have this idea that only for people to show on the training, they already have the right to be there, they already a winner and somehow. So people just try to do a precision jump like it was first time ever. I don't know. I already, oh, that's good, nice. And always positive feedback, I think, tends to get better results than, oh, and just throw information like, you can do the arm like that. And I think feedbacks are important, of course. But I know I tend to pay attention the timing of feedback. So always I have this motto, like it's always positive feedback first, and then after, oh, you can do better, like you can do this and do that, but it's all good, you know, keep going and trying. So the person don't think I'm doing wrong, like I'm doing great and I can get better. So it's like, it's just words, but it makes a lot of difference when you're coaching and I don't know, in daily basis, I think it's the seeds, right? So mm-hmm. it's step by step. So you're putting this concepts on the mind of, you're putting the concepts on the mind of the student, but yeah, it's true. So it's a lot of positive feedback. I think it can be the basis of the learning, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think, for example, I agree. I think that a common thing that happens in my classes is that a child will use their knees to climb up onto something or use their elbows. And there's, you know, as a coach, there's two ways, not just two ways, but there's several ways of dealing with this. One way could be,
yes,
put your knees, take your knees off, take them off.
Yes.
Why are you doing it? You've already done it once. Don't do it again. Otherwise, you know, and having this real authoritarian, almost aggressive kind of attitude, because it's wrong, you know, it's wrong. Mm-hmm. But if you change that, you could say, oh, hey, well done. Hey, I've got a challenge for you. Why don't you try next time? You're only allowed to use your feet on the top. You're not allowed to use your knees. Have a try. See if you can do a challenge. And then when they do it, big high fives. And, you know, I think, and just that, the, it's so, you know, your voice as a coach is your greatest asset. And
yes,
it means that you really have to be careful and how you frame your comments and your, these form your relationships with your students, the way that you talk to them.
Yes.
So yeah, I've been guilty of being a bit too strict, especially towards the beginning, because I thought that, you know, if they're not making my version of progress,
yes,
then they are failing. Then they're not doing well. But now I take a step back and I think, well, they're brave enough to come to the session, which is something to be celebrated first. They're brave enough to try a challenge in front of me, in front of other people, and that has to be celebrated. And the ones that get it, the ones that parkour starts to stick to over time, and like you said, with patience, I think that naturally they start to adjust for what they realize, this doesn't work. Putting my knees on is slow and painful. You know, that they start to understand what works. And so, yeah, you're right. Having that environment that's not just authoritarian.
Environment. Yes, that word, environment, right?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And you create that environment through how you conduct yourself with the session. Cool. Yeah.
I don't know. I have a question. I know should be answered, but
yeah, yeah, yeah.
In parkour gyms or outside training, I tend to observe. I was at some point in these years, someone who was always, I was shaming about doing stuff in front of others. Like I was not comfortable sometimes. Mm-hmm. In parkour trainings, so in parkour gyms and etc. So I know the community sometimes have these strict ideas, and you not should put your elbow like you're saying, and for a climb up or anything. And I was talking with some girls in the women's gym we had in January. Here in Brazil, and they said the importance of parkour gym women's parkour gym that we had, it's because the environment is more open for us in some way. And sometimes girls and women don't feel comfortable to train, to make mistakes in parkour training with guys and when in their hometowns and whatever. So once I was this girl, this who was too shy to try, and recently it turned something in my mind, like, but if you don't try, you don't get better. Like, you have to try it. You have to be, you have to allow yourself be, not good, awful, like, to get better, for you know what you have to improve in, whatever. And I don't know if it's common in other countries, because here in Brazil, as I was saying, I know as a fact that women tend to feel the same way, but I don't know if in other countries in Europe it's like that too.
Are you asking do women and girls feel generally a little bit more timid?
Yes, not only girls and women, but and beginners. I don't know if you notice something like that.
Yeah, I would say it's very common, very common. Yeah, I think that I've talked about this before in the podcast, in that, you know, the things that inspire us also tend to frighten us. You know, so seeing Dom Tomato doing the biggest front flips and seeing the craziest, most highly skilled boundary pushing movement can be very daunting for people that want to just start, because they think, how on earth can I ever do that? How can I be that person? And so there's this kind of constriction of like, well, I'm not them. I'm small and I'm weak. And so I find there's a bit of a paradox in parkour about what we show and what we inspire with, because maybe showing yourself failing, like you do, for example, with all your flip progress, you know, you're doing lots and lots of repetitions and falling and getting back up and trying again. And, you know, maybe these things are more useful to help inspire beginners. To answer your question, I think that, yeah, I see a lot of self-consciousness in beginners when they come to a big jam, or there's, you know, Callum Powell in the room, or there's a competition. Like, for example, I was at Project Underground, which is like a big competition. Did you see any of the...
I saw.
Yeah. So it's a huge competition, amazing. Like, people from Europe and all over the UK all come together, 230 people or something. Wow. Yeah. So, and it was interesting talking to different people, and some of them being beginners and some of them watching all of these incredible things and them feeling quite frozen. I can't do that, or I'm not good at doing that, or I don't want to do this in front of everyone, you know? So I think as well, just because it's a big jam doesn't necessarily mean that everyone feels comfortable. And I think that to take responsibility as an experienced practitioner and as a coach, if you see people like that, you should just go and hang out with them, you know, like, if you have the time and kind of the awareness to see them, you should go and just hang out with them and just ask them how their training is going, work on them with something, you know. Oh, what are you struggling with? Oh yeah, I'm struggling with this too. Why don't we try it together? You know, like, show your vulnerability rather than just all of your strengths.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think it is a not a problem, but like a, it's a thing. It's a thing.
Yes.
That we have to deal with as coaches, I guess. So, yeah.
I agree.
And whilst we're talking about kind of technique and things as well, I really liked your climb up tutorial or your climb up tips. And it seems that you have a little, you've had a revelation about what helps with climb ups. And you mentioned about timing.
Yes.
So could you explain this, please? Because I think it might be very helpful to a lot of people. So.
Number one technique people get ask me for, I don't know, get the tutorials, make tutorials and tips, it's climb up and comb, but and I don't think I have a good technique for climb ups, but I'm working on it. And what I perceive, what I noticed when I was training, it was sometimes people think that I'm not strong enough, but sometimes it's just the timing for the transition, right? So sometimes you get earlier on the transition and your elbows stays down. Like, and when you pull yourself and you put your elbows up, just wait a little bit more, like you can do this transition with your elbows high. So you struggling, like you struggle less than when you pull and your elbows are down. Like, it's just a thing that I noticed when I was climbing and I was like, okay, but what I'm doing wrong? Because it was not like I am not weak. I don't know how I say that, but sometimes I see people like that can do muscle ups, which is more harder and takes more strength for doing, and still remaining struggling with climb ups. And we have this foot, we have this support, now lean on foot, I don't know, but it's easier like to do a climb up than a muscle up, but people tend to struggle with climb ups because of time, not because of because they are not strong enough. I think it's just it. I think people tend to, all the words are fading out, but they pull and just want to make the transition earlier than it should be. So when you pull yourself, you tend to pull a little bit more and just for your elbows get high in a comfortable way.
And have you seen some progress by telling people these tips?
Yes, there's one guy that sent me the comparison that climbed up before and after he saw this reel, right? And last year I was with this challenge because my climb ups always terrible. I always struggled with climb ups, and I was with committed with this challenge of doing 10 climb ups after in the end of each session. So it was like 10 climb ups, it's easy. So but when I started, it was like I think July, I was doing like one of time, yes. Mm-hmm. And at December, yes, I finished in December, and I was like doing 10, like for a Siri. So it was an improvement for me. And I was just, 10 climb ups for each session, it's good. I don't need to do something more, like really schedule and whatever. It's just for just commitment, right? So being consistent with this challenge helped me a lot. And I think people always want to, like, the big secret to improve. And like I was saying something like, you have to do this. And, okay. And magically, okay. No, it's just consistency with you. Be patient and consistent with your training, you get better. So I think this makes more difference than, I don't know, a magical tip.
Sure. Yeah. And I noticed that you use, when you're teaching outside, I've seen that you've used some very, very simple equipment. So yes. just spots on the ground or cones. And I was wondering how, what's my question? Yeah, I guess I'll stick to what I wrote. So what goes through your mind when you're planning a session, especially with very simple equipment?
I started to train parkour and there was no parkour gyms.
Yeah.
Actually, here where I live, there's only one parkour gym that I work there, and I don't want to go there again. So I train outside, and it was the only way I can train parkour. It's outside with in squares and parks and etc. If I learn I have cones now, but when I started we don't have that. So I started exploring the surroundings, the things that we had there, like the floor and whatever. So I thought that it can be possible to teach, to coach parkour with this equipment, right? And when I talked the cones and the spots, because I was a runner coach in college, runner coach, is that right? So, and we used a lot cones and spots on the ground to do some warm up, and they helped a lot with the strides of the runner and the coordination and motor learning and etc. So at the beginning I thought, well, if a parkourist can run correctly with a stride more effective, obviously he or she can do better jumps and precision jumps and other techniques that we need to run. So I think running is a basic technique in parkour that we don't pay attention enough. But when I started, I thought that, I can do warm-ups with some exercises, with technical exercises to improve running, right? Mm-hmm. And I started like that. But then sometimes I was like, but I can use this to, I don't know, teach a vault and, you know, do other things. And I started to explore this with my students and it worked. Like, it's working kind of as private. I like to, I see a lot of tutorials in YouTube, on Insta about parkour movements, but I like to explore also. Like, I don't know, I tend to be really creative in classes because I was like, well, if it goes wrong, okay, it was something didn't work out. I don't have much prejudice, I don't know, with things that I try in class. So mm-hmm. I keep trying and some things get, some things really, really work out.
Yeah, I'm the same. I every week when I'm planning my sessions, I actually rarely have a similar session. You know, for throughout the week, I'll teach a similar theme for different classes, but that theme of, for example, strength or teamwork or balance or control, the session could look quite different to the same themed session, you know, 6 weeks ago. I find it very hard to repeat the same thing. I generally experiment quite a lot with my equipment, how I use it, different games. And I think experimentation is really crucial because you have to keep up the novelty.
I think parkour, yes.
Parkour thrives on novelty, you know, whether it's a new idea in the same spot or going to a new spot and finding ideas. I think that novelty is really good for our excitement about parkour and our engagement. And that leads me on actually nicely to a topic about longevity. And so you've been training parkour for a long time now. How many years has it been now? Did you say?
I started in 2009.
Okay, so a year after me.
Yeah.
So we've come from a very similar era, I think.
Yes.
And so.
Lavaca's era.
Yes, indeed, indeed. Yeah,
my hero. Thanks.
My hero. Yeah, I finally met him actually.
Yes.
Yeah, I met him last year, so it took me 13 years to meet him.
He came to Brazil once.
Yes.
And
I think I saw those videos. I think I saw them a long time ago. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was 2018, I guess, something like that. I saw him. It was a huge gym, and at some point he was doing the strides and a very high setup of bars, like, yeah. And everyone, and then he goes away, and, okay. But he came to Brazil, yes.
Lovely, lovely. And so something I noticed, you mentioned again on one of your captions, your nice, long, very well-written captions, is about the phase of training that you're in right now. You described it as a technical assimilation phase. And you sort of mentioned that you're not as keen to learn all the new stuff and do big crazy things, but you find a lot of enjoyment in just polishing and really refining the things, the movements, the tools that you already have. Is that right? Am I along the right lines there?
Speaking in longevity, my relationship with parkour changed a lot, like in this passing these years. And in 2000, there's where I think about 2 years of this parkour journey I had. I became sedentary. Like, I was in college, I was doing my master's, so I was studying a lot and working, and I don't like to remember. It was very stressful time for me, so I was not training like anything. I was always running, dancing, and doing stuff. And at some point of my life, I catch myself like reading for, I don't know, five hours straight. And I was like, what am I doing with my life? So, and then 2 years like this. And when I came back for parkour or training, my body wasn't aware of what I'm doing. So it was really challenging. And I felt like I was the beginning again. Like I felt like a beginner again. And it hurts my ego a lot at the time. But I decided like, okay, but I came back. So I'm dive, like, go for it. So and I started to work on this parkour gym I worked at until 2020. And I decided to give it a try to flips. And which I was never tried before. And I noticed that I am really afraid of turn my head upside down. Like, I don't know why. I scream sometimes and that's okay. I'm progressing, okay? I'm really afraid of hikes too. So
yeah.
It's funny because sometimes people in my family or I, when I met some new people, they like, oh, you do parkour, right? Ah, you're really, really brave. Like, not really, but I'm trying to be like, I'm brave to go to every sesh, but I never consider myself like this adrenaline junkies, like, I have to jump and have to feel. I don't like it. It's not natural for me to put myself in this position, like in a high, in I don't know. It's not just not natural, but I'm improving. So, it's when I decided to go and to challenge myself more, because until then, in 2009 and until I think 2014, I was like really comfortable with my trainings. Like, I train parkour, I like it, but I don't want to improve myself. I don't know. It was like kind of thing that I like and enjoy people who train with me, but I don't want to improve, like, it's okay. But in 2018, when I came back, I'm like, okay, I want to do this right. And I put some effort to it. So, and 2018 was there, it was this, but in 2019, I started to work as a manager. And here we have this term, I was searching for a translation before, that is coordinador técnico, I think it's kind of head coach, something like that.
Okay.
So okay. Manager and a head coach of this parkour gym. So again, I was catching myself like on the screen and thinking and not training. And I was like, no, this is not what I want also. So I want to train more. In 2009, I was training like once a month, 2 weeks, and I was not improving again. So into 2020, I decided to, okay, I'm gonna improve. I'm gonna train like I think it should be. Like, I think a parkour practitioner who's sometimes claims on Insta bio that a parkour athlete should train. So I'm gonna do the list, the minimal effort to improve. So, and then I started like 2 years from now, and I decided to train things that I am not comfortable, like running precisions. I always like, that's okay, running precisions. So I'm gonna try, I'm gonna train monkey precisions also, conk precisions, and high, then do flips. And I started to, like, I think 2 years from now, to dedicate myself, like intentionally dedicate myself to improve, really improve. So, it was very common to feel like this novelty of training because I was unblocking. I don't know if I here in Brazil we call unblocking like when you do one move for the first time.
Okay.
And I don't know if
We would say like breaking the jump.
Jump, right. So breaking the jump was I was feeling like I was breaking the jump very constantly in trainings, right? So, and there was a time that, okay, I'm not breaking any jump. So I call it like assimilation phase. Like, okay, and because I felt like, oh, I'm not improving anymore because I'm not breaking any jump in this kind of way. So I felt like, but it's okay because I'm assimilating the techniques that I already know, whatever. I'm not feeling this novelty, but I'm feeling I'm still improving, right? Mm-hmm. It's not only when you break some jump that you improve in parkour. It's like you have to do this phase, like refining technique. Yes. So I think that the post you're saying, I was feeling just like that because I reflect a lot what I'm feeling when I'm training because I tend to get really frustrated sometimes with my trainings, my movements, and sometimes I saw in video, I was like, oh, it's not what I wanted, but I posted anyways because I think it inspires a lot of beginners to see me fail, to see, as you say it, right? See me fail, to see that it's possible, and to see the process, because it's kind of easy to see, star guys who are really famous, right? So a lot of people, like, when I say, I do parkour, oh, okay, I saw a star video and something like that on YouTube, like, oh, okay. And it's easy to normal people say, parkour is not for me because just have this reference. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. when they saw me, like when I was training, I was like, oh, okay, I can do that. And I think it's a balance. I think it's fair to have a lot of references. So people can think, oh, okay, there's Thor, there's Raíssa, there's other people, and I can, it's possible for me also.
Mm-hmm. And you also mentioned that there's a problem with sedentariness in Brazil. I'm not sure how wide the analysis was, but you were saying that there's a problem with sedentariness in women in Brazil. Am I right here?
Yes. Yeah, so I think I tend to talk about it a lot because it's not only Brazil, like it's a worldwide problem, right?
Sure.
So yeah. I don't know where I tend to talk about it a lot because I think there's this restricted rules that sometimes community, not just of parkour people, but fitness culture and other sports that have this culture, like of some rules. So I don't know if I think I say that in a post, in a caption, when I was really pissed off because one guy from here was just saying in his Insta that why is so wrong do push-ups with knees on the ground? Like only real push-ups is with food, you know, and come on, people already get so hard time to get into any physical activity, any, and people already choose parkour, which is not common, I don't know, and you're saying, you're just, I don't know, telling the people that they're doing wrong.
Yes.
And come on, is that the problem? Like the knees on the ground, is that the problem? Like most of people in the world is not, you know, piss me off. You're seeing like. I think there's bigger problems than, I don't know, if you put your elbows on the top of the wall, or if your knees are on the ground, or if you do one precision with the ankle, like, you know, there's some things I think people should celebrate, you know, be congratulated by going to a sesh. Like, I think that is more important than if, I don't know, if the person.
I get you. Yes. I get you. I can tell you're very passionate about this.
Yes.
No, I agree. I think that it's how you focus. It's what you're focusing on. You know, are you focusing on celebrating people for being active, or are you focusing too much on the small details? Small details can count, but it's tact, it's timing. It's not, you know, and these are things that you need to develop as a coach, to be a good coach.
I tend to explore a lot of other sports also. So there was a time last year when I was training flips, and a friend of mine, he practiced taekwondo for a few years. So he was like, what about if we warm up with some kicks? Yeah. And I was like, okay, I never kicked before, but I'm gonna try. And I filmed it and posted on Insta after, just to, so I warm up like this, and I do this, and I do, I show the whole process of the practice we had. So, and I was like kicking for the first time in my life. I don't know how to kick. I don't know. I'm not fully aware of what I'm doing, but I was doing, and I'm doing pretty good. I did great, I think. But, and somehow, like, I think about five guys started to teach me, like, in my DMs, how I could kick better. And I was like, it was my first time, and like this huge test to them. I was like, it was my first time. You don't have to assume this position. Like, people can't just, you know, have to start knowing. It was not, it's contraintuitive, intuitive. I don't know.
Yeah,
it's counterproductive. Not,
unsolicited advice.
Yes.
Do you
Man's
find?
Playing.
Yeah. It's a problem in parkour. Well, it's a problem across society, but a problem in parkour as well. And I think that it's just having some self-awareness before. I try and be as aware as I can, and hopefully. Because it's okay to give advice, but again, it's the timing, it's the tact. I like that word, tact. It's good. Having tact is good. I think, and not just firing off,
you know, your top tips to someone you've never met before and that they've never asked you for your advice, that sort of thing. I can imagine, especially for women, it's very annoying and not really very helpful.
No. It's funny. Then I, not only at this time, but when sometimes there's a guy, always a guy, I don't know why always a guy, but as a guy, who wants to talk me something, I don't know. And I usually I share, like, oh, look, who is teaching me right now. And there's a lot of women that came in and say, I posted, I don't know, I doing push-ups, I posted and I was a gym. And it's very common. It's very common.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For men listening, what advice would you give to them about how to conduct themselves?
They didn't ask. I don't know.
Shut the fuck up.
It's funny because there was a time, there are sometimes I like put up some question box like, I did this today. What can I improve? Like something like that. When you ask, you can. So, but when I ask, it doesn't happen. I don't know why. It's just when you don't ask, okay, I'm gonna give some unsolicited advice.
Yeah. That's funny. when you ask, nothing there, just silence. Yeah, that's funny, man. Cool.
Can you take a break just to get some cup of water?
Yeah, of course, Yeah.
Okay.
Go for it.
It's really fast.
We're back.
All right.
I did get one question, so I'll ask that soon. But before we do that, I want to ask one more for myself.
Okay.
Because, yeah, I think that how do I phrase this? What's the best way of phrasing this? There's been 12 years of women's gems in, okay, how do you pronounce the area? Espirito Santo?
Right, right. Yeah? Espirito Santo.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so there's been 12 consecutive years of women's gems there. Do you help organize this? Are you a participant? Were you a participant? How has this journey been for the last 12 years with the women's gems? Just tell me a bit about them, yeah.
Okay. Parkour community, women's parkour community here in Brazil is very strong. So 12 years, right? So 2009, I guess, or 2010, yes. There was the first women's gym here in Brazil. It was in São Paulo, which is another city than other than Espírito Santo. Espírito Santo means Holy Spirit.
Oh, cool. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and São Paulo is Saint Paul. Paul, yes. But São Paulo. It happens in São Paulo in 2010. The goal of this gym, it was like when I said before, women get more comfortable training parkour because the environment where the São Paulo girls was training was not very receptive to women. So they decided to do a parkour gym only for girls. And in 2011, it happens again in São Paulo also. So, and at that time, I was like, oh, I'm going to. Like, I'm from Curitiba, but I'm going. Like, I was another city, but I'm going. And at the time, I invited a friend of mine I was like, I'm going to São Paulo to a parkour gym. Do you want to come there? And she didn't training parkour or anything, but she was like, okay, let's go. So we went to, and it was experience real, really excited for me, because I was the only girl, only woman in Curitiba, which is my city, who was training parkour at the time. So when I saw these other girls, I was like, oh, and they feel like, you know, we have the same fears, the same feel about training, and I feel very comfortable. It was environment very, I like it a lot. And my friend also started to train. Not right now, she's not into parkour anymore, but she's into CrossFit and whatever. Mm-hmm. But and in this gym in 2011, we decided as a group, like, why we can just put this event like every year in some different city of Brazil. Because nice. There's a lot of women that can't come to São Paulo to, you know, we can do in other cities also. So, and we decided that, and by every year, by when you're voting, like voting.
Yeah.
I don't know the word, but every year we decided by voting where the gym will be. So there's gyms in Rio de Janeiro, Nordeste também, que é Northeast of Brazil, Belo Horizonte and other cities. And in 2018, it was in Curitiba, and I organized it. So every year, a group of girls, a different group of girls organized the event. So, and right now in January, it was in Espírito Santo, and I was invited to do a workshop, a little workshop with the girls and the guys also who participated. So, and not only me, but other girls from different cities also did a workshop, and it was pretty fun. Like, I think, and it's so well organized, like, we have the free t-shirt, free
nice.
Free lunch, free, I don't know, it was almost everything for free, like, because the group, like, actually in Espírito Santo, it's only Caru, which is a parkour practitioner that I admire a lot, and she is very organized person, so she came with everything, and it was a huge event. I think it was one of the best, like, in these years.
Could you describe briefly some of the things that you were teaching, or like an example of like a drill or a practice that you were doing?
When I was doing this workshop at FOG, where of what I'm working on, focusing right now, which was the strength training, like preparation, physical preparation, I don't know, for parkour, and thinking about the common injuries parkour people have. So, like the ankle thing, the tendinitis, I guess. I don't know when there's inflammation on the tendon, like on the shoulders, because parkour people tend to be really, I don't know, this posture. What?
Hunched.
Hunched, yes. So, I don't know that there's some exercise for open the chest and strength and whatever, and something like that, some tips like that, and some exercises, and we do this practice, and something like that.
Cool. Okay, well, I guess we'll go on to a question that we got from the Q&A. This one comes from Flynn Disney, a good friend of mine. Have you ever met or spoken with Flynn before?
I spoke with him, but only on Insta. Like I saw a post, and I don't know. I think I asked a video reference that he was sharing. But anyway.
Yeah, you should join his group, the online exploration group.
He said that I can't write at the moment, but I want to.
Yeah, it's worth the time. It's worth the time. It's good. And he asks, what does it mean to be a leader for women in parkour? What do you want to lead women towards?
That's
easy question.
It's challenging because I don't know. You read a lot of captions I wrote, right? So I don't know if you came to one that it's really challenging for me assume this position like woman leader. I don't know, because at right now I am intentionally at this position, but it was not always like that. I started as a parkour coach actually because the guys who was planning this workshop, they were thinking like, we need to woman reference, because when where are we going, there's guys, but there's women too, but women tend to see what we do as a guy thing. So if you come with us, I think they will be more open and to try parkour also, you know? So when I went like, okay, I'm going. Then I was always like, I always assumed this position like, okay, if you, I don't know, if there's anyone to do it, I'll do it, right? So it's very recently I thought like, okay, I already am a kind of, I don't know, reference or leader or whatever. And I think I can be more intentional about it. So what was the question?
I just got it again. Yeah. So what do you want to lead women towards?
I want to lead like, it's I think it's only hard because to answer that, because it's challenging for me to apply what I want to leader also, you know. So I think women can do so many things that sometimes somehow they think they can't, like, and I think we really restricted of what we can do, and sometimes it limits us. And I don't know, I think it's past these limits that we accept. Like we accepted for a long time, and we still accept in some levels of conscience. Like, and I think we can not do better, but do more. And if we just don't believe in these limits, we think we have, we accepted we have, something like that.
Okay. Well, Flynn, I hope that answers your question. Yeah.
I want to thank you for hosting me. I don't know. It was really surprising for me to get this invitation. So thank you.
Have you seen, did you watch Lost in Translation yet?
No! But I've heard of it. So
yeah.
It was like, oh, Lost in Translation, yeah, the movie. And in Portuguese, it's Encontros, yeah. It's Encontros.
Yeah.
It's Get Lost in Translation. So.
Yeah. What is it? Encounters and Meetings.
It's
or
Encounters.
Something.
Yes. Like, what?
Yeah, it's a nice film. It's set in Japan, I think.
Mm.
And it's about it's kind of a romance, but it's an older guy and like a younger woman, and they kind of just form this friendship. And they're both American, so they're in Japan in a very different place, and they kind of form this friendship, and it's well made. It's nice. It's not a typical, like, you know, cringy, swoon-worthy romance. It has some like reality to it, and yeah, it's it's good. It's good. Yeah. So,
nice.
I, so when you watch it, you can give me a review. Tell what you
okay.
think.
Okay. I'm gonna watch it.
Nice. And have you got classes this evening? Have you got any? Are you teaching today or?
No, only online coaching. Actually, I do this spreadsheets. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Of this training, so I have to review some kind of this.
Do you have? Yeah, I didn't mention that actually. I was interested in your online coaching. Do you do that for clients around the world?
Yes, I was, but only Brazilians.
Okay.
Just because they came to me,
yeah,
like
yeah,
my
yeah.
Insta.
Yeah.
It's all Portuguese, so you know. But
sure.
There was one client of mine that was, I think they, no, he's living in Canada right now. So, but he's Brazilian, so he understands
okay.
Portuguese, and
yeah.
And yes.
And do you?
But online, and Camila, obviously, she's in Lisbon, and we do online.
And do you? How does that? I mean, we're running out of time, so it's probably the wrong time to ask. But just very quickly, how does it work? Because I've thought about doing it for a while, but I haven't felt qualified enough in a way. You see a lot of online coaching everywhere and people are very knowledgeable, and I feel like I could help a lot of people, but also I don't want to get it wrong.
Yes.
So do you teach more a specific, like, is it more specifically strength work, or is it analyzing the technique, or is it like, yeah, what does it look like?
I want to expand, but currently I work with only strength training, flexibility training, and cardio. So I upload a lot of exercise videos on my YouTube channel, and I do this organization like of the training with this the videos, and every week we talk like, how was your week and whatever, and it works, not works, and etc. But it's more focused on strength and flexibility and cardio.
Okay.
I want to, you said like, get a specific movement. Like I want to do that. I still don't know how to do it. I think online coaching is, it's really, it's a possibility. Like it's good, but I don't know how to do it with in some way I get satisfied, and like I think it's good enough. Yes,
okay,
I think it's good enough. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking about it. I'm thinking about expand, like not just strength, flexibility, and cardio, do some more things, but let's see in the future.
Mm-hmm. And any plans to travel outside of Brazil?
Yes, Camila asking me a lot. yes, I pretend to go to Lisbon, I think next year. But next year there's a lot of things to resolve before. To resolve to, I don't know, get done. I think get done works better.
Okay. Cool. Well, I'm sure it'll be very exciting to go somewhere different and see Camila again and.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, from me, muito obrigado. Thank you so much. I have a lot of respect for what you're doing. I really appreciate what you're doing. And I think that your all your efforts are worth looking at. So if you're listening or watching, then yeah, go ahead, look in the description. I'll put all the links. We've got right to the end and I haven't even asked what's the proper pronunciation of your name?
Raíssa. Is.
Okay. Yes. So it's not like the British racer.
No. Here in Brazil, the R on the yes, like it sounds like H, right? H.
Yes. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So yeah, if you want to check out all of Raíssa's stuff, then go ahead, look in the descriptions. Go and check it out. She's very active on Instagram, particularly. So if she puts up some ask me a question, then that's your opportunity to ask some questions or give her some solicited advice. So yeah.
Please, unsolicited advice, no.
Yeah. But yeah, thank you everyone for listening. Thank you again and see you on the next one, everyone.
Thank you, Sam.
So, that's the end of the episode. Really hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for sticking around, whether you caught it on YouTube or Spotify. If you did enjoy it, hit subscribe on YouTube and you'll be updated with new episodes. Likewise, on Spotify, you can hit follow. As always, I love hearing feedback, good or bad or ugly. So please get in touch, get involved. I want to be part of this community. I want to hear your thoughts. I put a lot of thought, care and work into these episodes. So if you really enjoyed it and want to support me and be a legend, then you can do so with the Buy Me a Coffee link underneath. This means you can give me some sort of donation, anything will do, and that will definitely energize me to make more of these podcasts and produce more content for you guys. Other than that, have a wicked day. Train hard, train safe, train soon.